son. All right. I'd like to bring out Damson Idris. He's the cast. Franklin Saint. As Isaiah Judd.
From Atlanta.
Yep, yeah. Angela Lewis. Auntie Louie. Auntie put that boy in the spot, didn't she? Sheesh. You ain't look like that on the show, Auntie. All right, can y'all please give them a round of applause, please? Okay, so I got a few questions. Is that cool? All right. So I'll shoot this to either you, Mr. John Singleton, or Dave. Why did you feel that it was important to tell this story? Like, what compelled you guys to tell this story?
Well, because it hadn't been told
Los Angeles, but I had never had an opportunity to deal with what happened pre the crack epidemic, you know, which was, it was still a rough place, but it got worse. And so I thought it was very, very important to try to do a story that would be based in there. It was always really in the back of my mind for many, many years of showing LA really in the late 70s, early 80s, late 70s, of how it was. It's a beautiful place. I mean, you see the palm trees and, you know, and the color, nice Spanish-style stucco homes and stuff, right? There weren't bars on the windows. A lot of people had open lawns. People were really proud of their lawns. They like manicured lawns, you know. There's a lot of the folks that are from L.A. immigrated from Texas and Louisiana, and they were proud to have. I mean, there they had, when they did have a little bit of money, if they did or didn't, they had, even if you had nothing, you had a little bit of some land, but it was all dirt, you know what I'm saying? So I just really wanted to do that.
Wow. Okay, so I like to aim this question towards Damson. Can you say it right for me, please? I don't want to be messing up your name.
Damson Idris.
Why, you didn't talk like that in the show either? Damson. Okay, so let me ask you a question, man.
I get that a lot. Damn, son.
Yeah,
Damson in distress. I get, damn, I got a son.
Damsel.
So let me ask you a question, man. And this is a pretty interesting question because it reminds me about Idris Elba in a sense. How did you actually prepare for this role, considering you're from UK? But looking at this, I don't think anybody in this audience would have ever been able to guess that.
Bless you, you guys are too kind. in London, we watch a lot of American movies, so it's really easy to kind of impersonate, but once you become an actor, it's amazing to be able to kind of find your own voice, and particularly with South Central LA, it's really easy when you're working with a director like John Singleton, and rappers like Dub C on set every day saying, yeah, you gotta talk like this, homie. It's real easy, you know. So I really got into it, the culture.
I'm just laughing at myself. Wow. All the girls giggling at his British accent.
Yeah.
it looked like it's working to me. Next season, I'll be speaking like that. Yeah. I don't want to.
It works.
It works. It definitely. So for Carter. All right, now. Yeah, you played a hell of a role, bro.
Yeah.
You like kind of got put in a situation, like you was in there cleaning up and everything, like, I mean blood, like DNA, bro. The CIA's role in the crack game has been speculated for years. Was there any eye-opening information that you discovered while researching this role? Like anything that made you feel like, oh, I ain't never think about it like that?
Yeah, also, I just was completely ignorant to the history of the way that the drugs were being moved around from South America into the country in this time. I had no idea. So for me, it was all really eye-opening. It was all really educational and scary. I mean, really scary to think that this could have happened.
Deep.
All right, look.
But you did your thing, bro. Real talk, you did your thing. I was like, okay, homie. Especially when you were sitting there with all the bricks on the table. On a phone call, like nothing's going on.
That's my favorite part, yeah. It's I like really all that. That cocaine. It's like
nothing but bricks. Yeah. All right, so, this is for Isaiah. Mr. A-Town himself.
Yeah.
You ain't talk like that in the movie either, bro. Let me ask you a question, man. Like, considering Young Cat from Atlanta, how in the world did you get involved in this project?
That was a process. I mean, to be honest, I didn't want to do it at first. I would tell you why.
Hold on. Time out. Hell no. Well, this is John Singleton.
Let me explain. It's not the story.
Because I would gladly fill in.
It's not the story. It's the fact that being from Atlanta, and because I am mixed, it's like when I would go in for auditions for African-American roles, they're like, oh, you're not urban enough. What are you? I'm like, I'm black. You know what I'm saying? So it's just like when I got the like offer to audition, I was like, they're not going to cast me. So that's what I mean by I didn't want to do it. It's like, I'll do it because I, you know, it's John Singleton and I love the story, but it's like, they're not going to catch him. They're going to be like, he's not black enough. That's what I heard all the time. So it discouraged me. You know what I'm saying? Just hearing that for so many times. And my sister, she's an actress as well. She is the same thing. So it's just like, it's not the story. I love the story. You know, but my manager, she's been following the story ever since 2015. And when she saw that they were, you know, casting, she was like on it. She emailed the casting director. And, you know, she was like, oh, he'll be perfect for Leon, but I'm not casting right now, so I'll keep him in mind. She's a hustler, so she's from New York, you know what I'm saying? She's pressing her, hey, Isaiah. So then I got the, you know, I got the audition. And next thing you know, I'm in California, chemistry with Dobson Idris.
Something that's amazing and, that a lot of people don't know about Isaiah, before he came to L.A. to play the role, a week before that, he was a janitor for 2 years in Atlanta,
yeah.
Which
right.
is
yes,
such
you know.
A testimony to God.
You know.
Wow.
Yeah, so that was crazy. And then I get to call my job from L.A. and be like, yeah, I'm not coming back, you guys. Find a new janitor. I'm not going to do that anymore.
Part of the beauty of living in the world we live in is that we get tapes from everywhere, right?
Right.
Like, we got a kid who's from London. He sends a tape, and all of a sudden we get him on a plane. We got a kid from Atlanta sending a tape. Like, it's kind of great that it branches out and we get to see people that, I don't know, 20 years ago, I don't know how we would have found these guys or how we would have gotten them in front of our faces, you know?
Truly inspirational, especially for any aspiring artist, I had an audience. It's kind of crazy because I saw you coming in and I was like, okay, he's probably going to be the good kid in the movie. Like you said, it's crazy. No, yeah. Seriously, because, and as I told you back then, I was like, bro, how you was the hoodest one in the movie, though? You was not with none of the BS. He's like, man, that was dope. I really enjoyed your role.
He's a sweet kid too. I don't know where it is down in him, but there's something.
Appreciate it.
It's
man.
That, it's that
no.
janitor shit, that anger. Cleaning out fucking toilets. Come with some heat.
Coming with it. Okay. So this is for Angela. Now, okay.
Auntie Louie.
Probably.
This is definitely like, all right, seeing you on the screen in character, I was like, okay, she gonna probably turn out to be a J. But looking at you walk up here, it looked like everything worked out well for you. Seeing that the women the women characters in the series are pretty nice, to say the least, I would say sexy. What impact do you think the portrayal of women in this show will have on viewers?
Well, I think all of the women characters are strong characters. So, and I think that's really important for us to keep seeing more and more and more on TV and film everywhere in all facets. I also think that the actresses and the actors too, but definitely the actresses bring a lot of love and humanity to their characters. And I think that's important to see because we can write these characters off in real life so much. And so it was really important for me, and I'm proud of the other actresses in my cast because it seems like it was really important for them too to bring a lot of humanity, a lot of layers to these characters.
Yeah, I mean, I'll give you this Easter egg because y'all came out, so I think you deserve to hear some things people won't hear, which one of the things is in early drafts of the script. We had Franklin goes to Jerome. Jerome says, all right, and Jerome takes him to a guy who owns a club. And when we looked at it and sat down, we were like, what if Jerome says no? And what if that's a part of his character? What if he really has been and isn't going to do it? And Louis comes and takes him. And what if it's not some guy they show? What if it's this woman who runs this club? And we really leaned into the idea of wanting to put some of these women at the forefront and raise their profiles and let them run some shit.
Because why as kept they do run everything.
I mean, because even me sitting back there watching, I'm sitting
there. Act like they don't, but they run everything.
In real life, we do it all for them. I mean, I can definitely tell you that. As I was watching, it is kind of interesting because I definitely thought that the uncle was going to be the one to be like, hell yeah, nephew.
Because he's been through some experiences with the coke gang that he wasn't, it made him really shook, which you'll find out, you know, in later episodes. That's why he was like, you know, I'm not going to mess with you with this.
Nice.
So he's really reluctant to get in the coke gang. He can sell weed and, you know, water, you know, PCP, but the coke gang is a whole other thing.
Coke. Yeah. Okay, so a question that the audience probably wants to know, how many episodes for this series?
There's 10 this season.
Yeah. 10.
We want y'all to watch it the night it comes
out. Yeah,
don't
no binging. No binging.
Don't wait. Oh, I'm recorded. No, we need to watch it. Not just like, you know, that first weekend you walk, go to the movies. That first night, you need to watch it. You know what I mean? Record it, like, go home tonight, put it on your DVR, and then tell, like, 20 friends to do the same thing, and then watch it that night. Because, you know, this is, you know, as much as you enjoy this, it's hard to get this stuff. This is real shit. Let's be real. This is hard to get this real stuff on TV. It's not like, don't take it for granted. So we need to, like, you know, support it.
Yeah, big okay. Shout to FX, man, for letting us push it. I mean, I don't know about you guys, but we kept, you know, we dropped a couple fucks in there in the pilot. We were like, all right, we'll see when they tell us to stop, and then they didn't say anything. So we like dropped a few more in episode 2 and a few more in 3, and by the end of the series, it's free for all.
No, it's a trip because
pretty awesome.
Last year. With OJ, they were allowed like one.
I know. I worked on Justified for 6 years. We couldn't say a fucking thing.
Yeah. it's called Standards and Practices. You know, it just keeps getting pushed and pushed and pushed. And now we're just skirting it right now with this show. This show's like watching a great rated R movie every week.
Yes. Yeah. It looks like it too. Real. The look of it feels it's wet. You know what I mean? That thing sauced up. Alright, so
we gotta give a shout out to our directors.
Yeah, yeah.
These two boys from Belgium, actually, Adil and Bilal, who are young men who did this movie by way of Morocco, Belgians, and they did a movie called Black that if y'all haven't seen, it's a few years old. It's fantastic. And we saw it, we were like, these guys can handle this material, and they shot the shit out of it, man.
So considering that, you know, me moderating this Q&A, I had some, you know, questions that were prepared. The audience, I keep seeing hands go up. I'll take a few questions if that's cool.
Hey, very, very powerful pilot episode. Congratulations on a good program. My question is for Dave. Considering you come from being a showrunner on Justified and now you're working with this gentleman who's really making his full foray into television, could you talk about what element you actually brought to this directorial style to really inform this show, and how have you polished it?
You know, I think having the experience in TV and kind of being able to maybe see that 10-episode arc in a way that somebody who's coming from films or having directed episodes, it's a hard thing to do, right? And it really does take a village, you know? Like, we had our writer's room, and we had John, who's always thinking cinematically, right? He's always thinking big. He's always thinking, like, what's that moment that's going to blow people away? But I like to think that I was able to kind of bring this overarching view to, like, all right, so we know what we want those moments to be, and we kind of know where we need to get to. Like, let's figure out how to do that with juggling 3 storylines, by the way, which is something I had never done, which was a huge challenge, but which allowed us some freedom in this to end every episode with, like, a massive cliffhanger in one storyline and also, like, tie something up with another one. So I hope that every episode you have this feeling of full satisfaction while at the same time you're like, fuck, I gotta wait a week? That's the hope.
Great question. I got another question in the back.
Hi there. My name is True. So originally, y'all shot a pilot for Showtime, which didn't get picked up. What did you do differently with FX, which I love the style of FX. I think they're really pushing.
We shot it for FX, and then, you know, we just got a chance to, like, tool it and make it better. Change some cast around and everything, but we shot that pilot for FX. But
it's just hard, you know, it's hard. It's really hard to make a good show, and the part of the beauty of FX was just we were able to look at some of the things that just didn't quite work and go back in and redo some things and, like you said, retool and look at cast. And it's hard to kind of quantify why sometimes things turn out the way they do and then why it clicks the next time, whatever. But again, big ups to FX for letting us get back in there and get our hands in the dirt again.
Big ups. All right, we have another young lady over here.
Hi, my name is Brianna Starks. First of all, I would like to say, John, love your work. I'm from California, and it definitely brought me back home. You know what I'm saying? It had that, definitely had that California vibe, the feel, the music, everything. My question is basically, being that you did say it was, you know, difficult to get this type of content and someone to pick it up, what was the process? Like, how long was the process from pre-production to getting it to FX?
This has been germinating for now like 3.5 years, from script and idea to, you know, to two pilots to actually doing the first season. So it's hard to say. It's just a whirlwind for me right now.
I'm 25 now. I was 23 when I booked the role, July 2015. Yeah. So I mean, to see it, I mean, it's not even airing yet. We still got 2 weeks, you know? It's like taking forever. So it's a long journey. And then who knows how long these guys have been going at it, you know?
Well, it takes a while to really get a good television show up. And when you really hit it right with the right network partners, the right team of people, creative people, the right cast and everything, like, you run on all cylinders. I think we've done that here.
That is. Yes, ma'am. You have a question?
Yeah,
sir. Okay.
Hey, how you doing?
Oh, sir. Okay.
First off, I want to say congratulations for all your hard work and the success of the show is going to be successful for sure. I wanted to shoot a question to Mr. Singleton about the Tupac movie.
I'm here talking about Snowfall. I ain't talking about Snowfall.
That's no Tupac. That is an answer in itself.
I'm here talking about Snowfall.
Listen
to me on Ed Lover tomorrow.
Okay. But thank you. I appreciate you all for coming out. Thanks.
Snowfall.
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 Right on.
Thanks.
Any more questions? Yes, ma'am.
Hey, guys. I've got a quick 3 parts. One for Angela. Angela, you make aunties everywhere. Everybody wants to you to be their auntie.
I love that.
How did you like dig into her as just like that gutter, go-getter kind of auntie? Second question. It's for John. You have a history of having a lot of hip hop artists in a lot of your films. Will we see any features? And then thirdly, David, I asked you outside if there was going to be a shocker moment. You nailed it. So I want to know if there are any more other mouth drops in the series.
Let Angela start first. You know.
Well, I would say that Aunt Louie and Angela come from two different places when they're like interacting with people and how they respond to things going on in life. And so it was initially really important for me to figure out how to drop my filters and not necessarily come from this place of love that I try to come from all the time. And, you know, it was kind of scary at first, you know, for the fight scene. We rehearsed it a lot because I was so nervous. And they were like, come on, like, you've been in a fight. And I'm like, I've never been in a fight. And then I was like, I had to give myself a pep talk, like, come on, Ange, like, what's going on? And I was like, oh, she just really don't give a fuck right now. So, yeah.
That's why you slapped me?
How you like how we had her, like, take her airways off as a commercial break? So, take her airways off. You knew it was about to be some problem right there.
All right, we got a question from a young lady up top.
Hi, good evening, everyone. John, congratulations, great movie. I wanted to also tell you, can you hear me? Okay. The TV show, okay, not movie. Okay. So I live
nine
in
more
LA.
Movies. Nine more movies.
Movie ever movie.
Okay. All right. So I lived in LA for 20 years, and I want to say everything about LA. I lived from there from 86 to 95. And one part of the movie that I'm really excited to see and wait to see the outcome. The London guy, I forget your name.
Damn, son. Look, everyone say it at the same time, please. One, two, three.
Damn, son.
One thing that I'm curious to know in the film, damn, son, your mom was
TV
doing...
TV show.
TV show, I'm sorry.
Not on the road right now, baby.
No, it's good. I like it.
Let me finish. So your mom was doing drugs at some point. I can't wait to see what that relationship is going to turn into because I want to know eventually.
She's getting high.
I smoke weed. Right. So my question is, and what I'm really wanting to know is she going to eventually start finding out about you doing, passing the drugs, and is she going to become addicted?
You got to watch the show.
I got to watch the movies.
You got to watch the movies every week. No, these people weren't about to reveal nothing yet.
We got
to
circle back for 1 second and tell you there is actually a huge great cameo later in the season by a hip hop guy, and there will be some every week that you'll be like, God damn.
The ones that could really act, because you know I don't really put people.
We gonna give him one?
Nope. No, they're not telling who, but it depends on who can really act and who is right for the show. It ain't gonna be just squeezing people in the damn show because they did a record. I've never done that. Everybody that I've worked with that has worked in hip hop, they pretty much have had careers after working on something I've been involved in. It's not like a novelty. Oh, put somebody in, you know what I mean? So hint. You might have to come with the chops.
You want to
get down.
Hey, man, we don't play no games.
You got to be able to cry. You got to be able to laugh.
You want to see me cry right now? Get over here,
Jack.
Yo. OG crazy. All right, we got another question somewhere?
This will be our last question.
Okay.
Sorry, y'all. Last question. My name is Cedric Young, and this is for Mr. Singleton. We see how it talks about how crack began. We all know how it's ended for a lot of people. Is this a show about the glorification of drug dealing, or what's the overall reach for this?
I mean, you see how nice and pretty the hood is and the opening of this. It's gonna get ugly. That's what, we have to start. You have to start somewhere to get somewhere. You have to start somewhere to make it really, really emotional to see where it's gonna get. So I don't think I've ever really glorified the whole drug culture in my thing to make people like, oh my God, I wanna go out and be a drug dealer right now. I saw this movie. Let me go do this. You know what I mean? Like, no, that's not what we're doing. But at the same time, we're not making something that's like so downtrodden that like, oh my God, I don't want to turn this on. You're going to want to watch this thing every week because you're going to be into what the lives of these characters cross-culturally, what they're going through with this whole trade. You know what I'm saying? And that's what I think makes our show differently from anything else that anybody has ever done. I mean, as much as I love The Wire, which is classic, it was beautiful. It's like one of the best shows ever. It was hard to watch, especially people who had lived in Baltimore because they lived it so much and they had been traumatized by it. But this show, if you're from LA or you know West Coast pop culture in a way, you're watching it and like wow, like you're curious as to what's going to happen. There's all kinds of different. There's humor, there's drama, there's pathos, there's profundity, and that's what we're giving you every week with this. It's interesting.
Yeah, I mean the canon of drug stories is there's a ride, there is a wish fulfillment element to it, there is the ride, and they never end well.
They don't end well.
And this will not be any different.
I just want to make a comment, Brother Singleton.
And it's also kind of, don't totally quote us, but kind of ghetto Game of Thrones. You never know who's going to die. I don't want to get...
Okay.
What was that?
Sound like he had something to say. No.
What's up?
What's up, brother? Okay. Okay. Well, on behalf of FX and the series Snowfall, I'd like to say thank you to each and every last one of the bodies that are in these seats.
Yeah.
I'd like to give a round of applause to Mr. John Singleton, Dave Andron, Damson Idris, Carter Hudson, Isaiah John, and the lovely Miss Angela Lewis.
Hey, IG, tweet out everything about Snowfall as you go out right now, and also program the DVR. Tell everybody to watch the show.
Hashtag SnowfallFX, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, thank you.